following show is paid programming and does not necessarily express the views and opinions of Urban Broadcast Media and its subsidiaries.
Thank you for listening to UBM Praise.
Jones Show, co-host Alvin Carter. We are a Christian talk show in where we tackle all the hot topics in a believer's walk.
Sir Walter Jones.
Who is it?
Sir Walter Jones.
What's his name?
Sir Walter Jones.
Whose show is this?
Sir Walter Jones.
Who is it?
Sir Walter Jones.
Say it again.
Sir Walter Jones.
Who are you with?
The Word of God is powerful, often misunderstood, but with proper study, you can gain accurate application of this potent source of life here on the Sir Walter Jones Show.
How are you? I would say, yeah.
Speak, Lord.
Speak, Lord.
Speak to me.
Speak to me.
Speak, Lord.
Oh, speak, Lord.
Speak to me.
Won't you speak to me?
Speak, Lord.
I was so blind.
Speak to me.
As religion and politics were becoming more closely linked in the decades after World War II, one religious group stood apart. They were conservative Protestants, evangelicals and fundamentalists who had felt scorned by the big city press during the infamous Scopes evolution trial.
Ever since the Scopes trial in 1925, America's evangelicals had really retreated from the larger society, and they constructed this vast, elaborate network of institutions to essentially protect them from the larger society.
They're operating their own churches, mostly white, many of them in the South. They're operating their own Bible colleges, which are actually very important institutions where young people can go and get an education very much in the evangelical Christian idiom. They're not seeking public power. They're seeking to sort of be left alone and to do their own thing.
Many evangelicals were not even registered to vote because politics is dirty and unseemly. And besides, Jesus is coming back at any time to get us out of this mess, so why should we worry about the temporal order? And that was a very, very real sentiment among America's evangelicals for the middle decades of the 20th century. This was an alternate universe within the larger American culture. It was possible, and I can attest to this personally, to grow up within that world, within that subculture, and have very, very little commerce with anyone outside of that world.
Hello, everybody. So welcome to the Sir Walter Jones Show. I am he. It is Thursday. Geology Thursday. Yeah. Are you black? Are you white? Who out there listening to me? I hope it's a melting pot. White America. Black America. What's up with the divide? You just heard a soundbite there from the American Experience show. Very popular show. I love to watch it on PBS.
Public Broadcast System, y'all.
God in America. And I'm telling you, today's show is not going to be nothing less than what we did Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. We're doing a race week guess you can call it, because I've been on it, y'all. Monday we talked about the descending factors of the black man. He's becoming an instinct almost. And then Tuesday we talked about Whitney Houston and her daughter and that particular saga. So we kind of sidetracked on that. Yet it's very relevant. And then Wednesday we, I don't know what we talked about Wednesday. We talked about something. I think it was slavery, right? Oh, yeah, yeah. The sin of slavery. Mm-hmm. A crimson stain that has been left on us. And what I want to do is I promised you guys that I was going to do this is not part two from yesterday, but it is a continuous in a different light. I guess you can say it's a season two. We're trying to figure out the white America, black America divide. Why are we so segregated in everything that we do, in our thinking and the way we walk and talk? I know culturally we're different. I like certain styles of music and they like a certain style. I mean, I like a certain delicatessen. They like a certain delicatessen. Okay, that's fine. That's not what we're trying to say here. Although I will say that there are two nations. There is a white. Now we have Hispanics who live here. We have Asians who live here. All right, and we have Czechs, and man, we got all kind of different cultures and races and creeds and religions and all have you. That's Illinois, not Illinois, but America is a huge melting pot. All right. Chicago. Yes, especially because there are different neighborhoods and don't get caught in that neighborhood after dark. All right. I'm just letting you know. L.A. is the worst, though, in the nation, because it is definitely the biggest melting pot in any city in the world. But we have two different nations, and even when you watch TV, there's two different races of people doing two different things, although they should be alike. For instance, when you go down to the South, they actually have two different proms. They have a black prom and a white prom. Did y'all not know that? Yes. We have always had black music, white music. We celebrated, we danced to the Soul Train. And they dance to American Bandstand. We have in gospel music, we have the Stella Awards, and they have the Dove Awards. We had BET TV, and they have Fox and everything else surrounding Fox. Okay, that's just the way America is. And at 11 o'clock on Sunday is the most segregated hour of the week. And Sunday being the most segregated day. It's segregation day, everybody. Wake up. Segregation day. God is divided. Hallelujah. But the Apostle Paul said in 1 Corinthians 1 and 12, he says, "Now this I say, that every one of you said, I am a Paul, and I am Apollos, and am I of Cephas, and I of Christ." He asked a very important question. Is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Or were you baptized in the name of Paul? He's saying, I'm glad I ain't baptized none of y'all. But these other two guys he mentioned in the 13th verse. All right. What is going on? So what I want to do is I'm going to kind of jump around here and I'm going to go to the two files that I said I was going to play yesterday. One was something about the U.S. and slavery. I don't know what number was that letter.
You made a K.
I made a K. JK. Okay, I didn't put it in my notes. Let's go to K, and just a continuous. If those of you didn't listen to yesterday's show, go to Spreaker.com tonight, and it's called "The Sin of Slavery." We kind of ran out of time, but this is K, and this is going to help you understand the United States and slavery, and let it explain it for you.
The Founding Fathers built a country committed to slavery. The site of Washington, D.C. was chosen as our capital in order to appease Southern slave owners. And why not? They held an enormous amount of power.
None of it exists without slavery. There are no settlements. There is no 13 colonies without slavery. There is no United States without slavery. There's no independence movement without slavery. The whole thing is built upon slavery. That's why they didn't abolish it.
Slavery was a part of American society from the very beginning. When the Declaration of Independence was signed, slavery was legal in each of the 13 colonies. And take this building here, our magnificent capital. Slaves quarried and cut its oldest stones. Its innermost bricks were laid by slaves. You see the statue of the Native American on top, symbol of freedom? One of the people who cast it was a slave. But even if the ideals of the American Revolution were perverted by slavery, the ideals themselves endured. They lingered in the hearts of black people, and they spread throughout the Atlantic world.
Yeah, that's without slavery, what kind of country would we have today? Because whether it's textile, or whether it's agriculture, or whether it's the Industrial Revolution, that's slavery. The cotton, you see what the cotton did for the South. Man, that's straight slavery. The problem with racism today, of course, from yesterday's conversation, it stemmed on slavery. And slavery was all over the world. Everybody was enslaving folks, but not for racial reasons, not because of the color of their skin. America was the only nation in the entire world that was enslaving people because they were dark skinned. That's amazing. Amazing history. Even in the Bible, it wasn't like that. It was on social class. Okay. It was on social economic situations. Never for because you had a certain pigmentation, skin graph, color scheme, that is. Amazing. So, yeah, so we're going to go here and talk about the beginnings. I guess I want to give you white history. All right. The white man's history in America. I want to play some bites from the PBS American Experience, God in America. And we're going to go down a list of why are the churches divided? How is it that we have two churches basically in America? Why is there a white church and a black church? I lived in South Dakota. There was one black church in that entire town, had one black pastor. Now, the church body in itself was, the audience was mainly white and Native American, but the pastor and the choir was black. It was just an amazing sight. And people would come visit us to say, what kind of sight is this? This is amazing. A black man over all these white people. That was it in the whole town. And I remember visiting another church on a Sunday morning. Got up, got dressed, drove to a white church. And I'm calling it white church, okay, just to get you to understand. And I walked in there, and they looked at me funny. And it's almost like they says, and you're here for who? I kid you not. And one said, oh, that the African American church is right up the street, about half a mile from here. I'm like, I'm here to worship with y'all. Oh, well, come on in, brother. It was amazing. I just couldn't believe it. But that is the culture of both the white church and the black church. Let a white man walk in your church, you who are blacks out there who don't have no white people in your church. Let him walk in and watch how much attention that's drawn to him. You guys are either going to be overly nice to that one white guy, or you're going to be looking at him strange, trying to figure out, okay, is he getting ready to arrest somebody in the middle of the service? Is he getting ready to shoot somebody? Why is he here? I kid you not. Now, I thank God I do belong to an intercultural church, where we do have we have whites at our church. Well, even though I can count the whites, we still have about four of them. But we've always had them coming in and out of our church. And that's because my pastor, Bishop Moody, is a worldwide missions man. He's an evangelist. So he draws them from all cultures and races. That's typical of that type of ministry. But the average black church in Chicago, you won't see white folk in there. Nope. Mm-mm. I dare you go to the South Side and look for an all-black church where there are some whites. you just won't see it. And if you do, there's that one that everybody gives special attention to because they have a white face. And it's the same way in those white churches where there's that one black guy, or he brought his family there, and they get special attention because they are what's called tokens. Okay? So where did all this stuff start? I'm going to go to what we call, do the alphabets with us, people. We're going to start at A. Jerry Falwell, OMG. He's not with us now, but that name rings supreme for those of you who were coming up the way I did. I'm calling this Blame Jerry Falwell.
One of those conservative evangelical enclaves was the Thomas Road Baptist Church in Lynchburg, Virginia.
Good morning. I'm Jerry Falwell, pastor here. And it's a real joy every Sunday morning over this station at this time to share with you our morning worship service. Isn't it grand to be a Christian?
Jerry Falwell, throughout his career up until the late 1970s, is resolutely apolitical. He delivers a famous sermon in 1965 called Of Ministers and Marchers, in which he says it's the duty of ministers simply to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ, not to become involved in civil rights reforms, not to become involved in anti-communism or anything else.
Falwell's associate pastor at Thomas Road Baptist was Ed Dobson.
Jerry Falwell was anti-political involvement at that time. As I recall, he had spoken against Martin Luther King Jr. And the marching, though he was against discrimination, but he just felt that Christians had, quote, a higher calling, and that higher calling was to preach the Bible and love people.
Jesus said, render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's and to God what's God's.
Pat Robertson was another young conservative televangelist who had rejected political engagement.
The big thing that we as evangelicals had to consider was our allegiance was to Jesus Christ. We represented eternity. We couldn't give our wholehearted allegiance to any particular political figure, however holy or righteous he might have been, because these are temporal things and we were dealing with eternal things.
Evangelicals saw the United States as a Christian country, established by Christians as a project of God, and all of a sudden, the 60s happened.
Yeah, so Falwell and his cohorts felt, and I can't argue too much with it, although it's part of a, it's kind of a cop out, especially in today's society. Well, shoot, back in the 60s, it was just like this, but it seemed to be worse. I think how you mask something, for instance, you could put a lipstick on a pig, but it's still a pig. And I think that's what's happening here, that we have put the lipstick on a pig today. Back then, there was the pig, but today, the pig just have lipstick on it. And so Jerry Falwell says, let's not get involved. My white evangelicals, do not go out there and get involved in any type of civil rights situations. Let Martin Luther Coon, as they would call him back then, let him deal with his black stuff. Don't even get involved with the Russian communism. Just preach the gospel of Jesus Christ and shut the door, okay, to our worship. And that's the way white evangelicals, that's the way they operated in America, all right? And they were very happy with this. Many of them didn't even vote. They didn't register to vote, okay? They just went to church and they went home and they closed the door. They were not in the streets doing nothing. They hid behind their Bibles. And Jerry Falwell was the president of that whole movement, okay? And then in walked Francis Schaeffer. I'm calling this the Francis Schaeffer effect. Some of you might, if you see his picture, go ahead and Google Francis Schaeffer, and you'll see his picture, and those of you who are my age will know who he was. And let's see what that effect is.
the secular forces in our nation had invaded the province of the church. We had the Vietnam War and the student rebellion, hippies and flower children and lots of drugs. And so what the evangelicals were essentially saying, we don't want you imposing your values on us. We don't want you taking our children away from us and imposing on them a secular worldview that is contrary to what we believe as Christians.
The threat of a more secular America would eventually drive conservative evangelicals out of their isolation and back into politics. The intellectual catalyst for that change was Francis Schaeffer, an American fundamentalist theologian working in Switzerland.
Dad was a pastor, had pastored of several small churches in the States, and really was a very obscure, marginal figure. No one knew about him. He was just another guy going off to Europe, in his case, to work with young people, and founded Le Brie Fellowship, a little chalet on the edge of the Swiss Alps. And essentially the mission was a place that opened the doors to young people who would come through and ask this American pastor questions about meaning and faith and the Bible and all these things. And then it grew from there until Dad was an internationally known evangelical leader and writing books. And I would look across the dining table and see Billy Graham or, you know, Gerald Ford's kids or whoever it might be.
Francis Schaeffer was this kind of funny-looking guy with long hair and goatee and wearing knickers and knee socks and so forth. And he was, for many evangelicals, especially younger generation, kind of the embodiment of the counterculture. When I was in college at an evangelical school in the early 1970s, Francis Schaeffer's works were kind of all the rage. And he would visit occasionally these various schools and give lectures, speak in chapel, and so forth.
Christianity is intellectually viable. Christianity is intellectually sayable to our generation. Christianity covers the whole spectrum of life. You need never be ashamed of it.
Schaeffer discovers that he'd really garnered quite an audience among American evangelicals. And he begins to try to propagate his ideas a little bit further. With his son, Frank, they produce a couple of film series shown particularly with evangelical audiences, and his foil was always secular humanism.
The consensus of our society no longer rests upon a Christian base, but upon a humanistic one. Humanism is man putting himself at the center of all things rather than the Creator God. Having rejected God, the humanist scientist taught,
once you surrender to humanism, he would argue, then all values in society would be up for grabs and we'd have moral decay.
Mm-hmm. And Francis Schaeffer was onto something, I think, very effective. The humanism, the secularizationism, and then, of course, in came inclusion, and all these other things began to creep slowly into our churches, and he was trying to push it out. Jerry Falwell was as well. But unfortunately, when you keep trying to ignore the elephant in the room,
elephant will break something.
Yeah, something about to break. And you live in a China.
China, yes.
So as they were trying to not be involved in the world, because I think we overly use, I live in the world, but not of the world. I understand the concept. But what we have done, though, is we took our lights and hid it in the bushel.
Yeah, and we forgot that we were supposed to impact the world and not detract from the world.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Now, we're supposed to be salt and light.
Mm-hmm.
It's important to understand how light operates, the characteristics. I'm looking for another word for it. Principles or the tendencies of light. It either reflects,
mm-hmm.
it either retracts, absorbs, or penetrate to go through.
Yeah.
And we're supposed to have that kind of impact, mm-hmm. of those four characteristics on the world. And we can't do that if we are stuck between the confines of our denominations or our four walls.
Nailed it.
You have to be under, you have to understand what's going on around you. He that winneth souls is wise.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And I love the scholars who say that he that taketh or snatches those souls is violent with it.
Yeah. Get over here. You need to be saved.
Get over here. Because the world going to snatch you. We'll snatch you out of church.
Well, the world is a little sneakier than that. they allure you.
Yeah, they are.
They make it sound good.
Yeah, yeah. I think I have a caller.
You must be a homeowner to take advantage of this special offer.
You gotta always answer that phone. Don't patch them in ever because they're looking for Alvin. See, Alvin, when he bought the house, he gave them this number as a reference. And so when he stopped paying the mortgage, they keep calling in.
What's the number again? Because I'm about to get another car too.
See what I'm saying? See what I'm saying? Yep, the car.
Use your address though.
Yeah, Uber gonna be calling.
There was a box right here. The wind blew it away. This is Thursday. Let's go back to normal.
Yeah. So anyway, in walk Roe versus Wade. Okay. Ooh. Now this is the abortion resistance because they were like, you know what? We don't even want to fool with even that. Let's just lift our hands and worship the Lord.
Uh-huh.
Okay? All right. Let's see what this file says.
The event that would propel Schaefer and evangelicals into political action was the 1973 Supreme Court decision legalizing abortion. But at first, it was the Catholic Church that led the opposition.
It was Catholic leaders more than evangelical leaders at the beginning who were most concerned about Roe v. Wade. In fact, Pat Robertson kind of famously said after the decision was issued that it wasn't necessarily a big concern of his. And there were Southern Baptist leaders who said that they didn't necessarily have a problem with the decision.
Francis Schaefer also resisted taking up the cause until, his son says, he persuaded his father to join the fight.
I said to Dad, let's really make a stand on it, like the Roman Catholics are doing, and really get out there and tell people we got to do something about it. That was the beginning.
In his next film series, Schaefer joined the abortion resistance with a direct call to evangelicals to get back into politics.
If in these last decades of the 20th century, the Christian community does not make a determined stand on the issues of each individual to have a right to live, and a right to be treated as made in the image of God rather than as a machine, I believe we have failed in the greatest moral challenge of this century. The choice is yours to make.
Francis Schaefer makes the case that not only should evangelicals consider entering into the political arena, but they have an obligation to do so.
Dad was the one who talked Jerry Falwell personally in taking a stand on abortion. Before that, Jerry Falwell said, that's a Catholic issue. It's nothing to do with us. Why would I want to take a stand on that? I'm just a preacher. I want to talk about the gospel.
Abortion is not a Roman Catholic issue. It is a moral issue. It is a
In 1978, issue. Falwell delivered his first sermon condemning abortion.
An issue that concerns the human rights of unborn babies who, by the hundreds of thousands, are being murdered in these United States of America.
In Washington, Francis Schaefer brought his anti-abortion message to conservative Republican leaders.
Dad was very persuasive, and the word began to spread. But then we also made some converts to our cause who were in positions of influence, for instance, Congressman Jack Kemp, who then invited us back to the Republican Club in an evening hosted by him and Bob Dole. And then soon after that, Dad met with Ronald Reagan and talked about this. They began to see it as a way to win elections. We began to see winning elections as a way to make our country a better moral place.
A lot of smart conservatives realized that with the rise of issues like abortion and school prayer, there were all these evangelical Christians kind of on the loose in politics. They were historically Democratic, a lot of them, but a lot of them were quite conservative. And so they set out to organize them, and they found Jerry Falwell.
Yeah, they found Jerry. And we're going to talk about that after this break here. Let's see. I want to hear from a comedian who's hilarious. White guy named Gary Owen.
He not white.
Mm-hmm. He married a black girl.
He light skinned.
He talk about the black church. He walked into the white, a black church, and had an experience you'll never forget. This is his stand up about the black church. We'll be back to our general show.
That's the one thing I didn't know. I didn't know. I got baptized at a black church, and that, you know. God, why does it take so long? Black church takes forever. I grew up going to white church, man, you know. Service starts at 10, 10:30. We're at IHOP, already enjoying our breakfast. Matter of fact, I went to black church, I didn't know, you know. I was just sitting there, and I was like, why is it taking so long? And then I finally realized, having this service, why it's taking so long, because when you go to church with white people, man, we don't say nothing, you know? When the preacher's talking, we shut up and we listen, you know? If somebody tries to talk while the preacher's talking, we tell them, shh, zip it, focus, okay? Two more songs, we're out of here. See, I didn't know when you go to a black church, I didn't know that when black people agree with what the preacher's talking about, don't wait. They yelled out right there, they agree. I didn't know, you know? So I was getting upset with the other people in the pews because I thought they were being disrespectful, you know? Because I was just sitting there, preach on it! Are you serious? You're just going to talk while he's talking? Why don't you zip in focus, man? It's 1:30, I'm ready to go home! Talk about it. Are you with him? What? You're allowed to talk? Are you serious? I'm gonna say something. Okay, watch. I'm gonna say something. Hootie hoo! I hootie hoo for Jesus, but come on, it's 3:00. I want to go home. Another song? Why is she singing Alicia Keys? That has nothing to do with Jesus. You guys have a step team? Are you serious? The First Baptist Steppers? It's 6:00. I want to go and starve and eat breakfast. A poet? You have a poet. This is a freaking talent show. Just want to go home. True story. Oh, my God. I always tell white people when I'm at my shows, I'm like, look, if you've never been to a black church, you gotta go. Just one time. I mean, don't make no plans. You ain't gonna catch the game. You ain't gonna catch the game. You know. But I always tell white people, I said, look, if you decide to go to a black church and you've never been, if somebody gives you a hard time for being there, just say Jesus, you know, because nobody messes with Jesus, you know. Like, hey, man, what are you doing here? Jesus. Who you know in here? Jesus. How'd you get here? Jesus brought me. And if Jesus don't work, just say Sister Johnson. Every black church has at least one Sister Johnson, okay? You're going to have a friend in there somewhere. Hey, man, what are you doing here, Sister Johnson? Who you know in here, Sister Johnson? How you know Sister Johnson? Jesus. We met at IHOP. 10:45. I was there last week.
Jesus.
He's a ball, Jesus talk.
Sister Johnson.
Jesus came in and never left me.
He right about that Sister Johnson, though.
Mm, there's about 10 of them in there.
At least about 6 of them in my church.
Ooh.
Sister Johnson. Mm. Yes. Six people say yes. Gary Owen, The Black Church. Great comedy. I'm going to give you guys seven shocking quotes by somebody. And you probably already know when I quote from them who this person is. One quote is, we don't want the word to get out that we want to exterminate the Negro population. That's one quote. Second quote is, I accepted an invitation to talk to the women branch of the Ku Klux Klan. The third quote is, they are human weeds, reckless breeders, spawning human beings who never should have been born. Mm-hmm. Fourth quote, birth control is nothing more or less than weeding out the unfit. Number five, human beings who never should have been born at all. Number six, I think the greatest sin in the world is bringing the children into the world. Number seven, but from my view, I believe that there should be no more babies. Mm-hmm. Y'all like, who in the world could possibly be saying these damnable things? Margaret Sanger. Who was Margaret Sanger?
The founder of Planned Parenthood.
Oh, absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh.
Mama abortion herself.
Yep. Eugenist. She's a eugenicist. She encourages
eugenicists.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. She encourages the sterilization of persons with less desirable qualities, and strongly encourages the reproduction of groups with more desirable qualities.
So did she sterilize herself? Because she ain't that pretty.
No, she is absolutely oogly. If that's the word. That's
she look like a man.
Uh huh. Uh huh. Sanger's disdain for blacks, minority groups, and the diseased and disabled spawned the birth of an abortion corporation that profits off the killing of the weakest and most vulnerable. From its conception, Planned Parenthood was built upon the roots of exterminating individuals deemed unfit for the human family. And that's what Hitler was all about. And the Hitler babies and what they call them, Hitler youths, actually. There were no other superior race other than them.
Most wars are about that in one form or another.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
When one kingdom that had the most technology, the greatest technology, and the greater, not always the greater numbers, but the greater technology and the communication, they come in to show that they're the greater people.
Mm-hmm.
And when they conquer, quote unquote, then they dominate their culture and impose their lifestyle upon them.
Mm-hmm.
Or they eliminate them or annihilate them.
Mm. Well,
I'm sorry. This is still happening.
Yeah.
Even now, you look at all the conflicts because they're careful not to say war anymore.
No.
Because there are clauses in insurance policies and all this stuff, so they don't say war.
No.
So they'll say events or mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Conflicts or mm-hmm. police actions.
Right.
Who do they send first?
Yeah. You.
Yeah. They'll send me before they send Bo. Or Luke.
Or Biff.
Oh, yeah, and Kip.
Mm-hmm. Today, the spirit of Sanger lives on, according to the Guttmacher Institute, the former pro-abortion research division of Planned Parenthood. African-American women are five times more likely to choose abortion over white women. Planned Parenthood clinics are strategically planned in minority communities, targeting blacks and impoverished minority groups, and abortion remains the leading cause of death for black community. Yeah. Now you're asking me, how did this turn into a Planned Parenthood show? Well, it's from the last file we just played. Notice I gave you, we call it C because I told y'all pay attention. Remember, A was blame Jerry Falwell. C was the Francis Schaeffer effect. I'm sorry, that was B. Now, C is Roe versus Wade, and you hear what they were saying about, we don't want to get involved in that. That whole abortion thing, we don't want to get involved. But here's what my controversial statement is. White women started having abortions, and then these white evangelicals got scared.
Mm-hmm.
Because they didn't start speaking out against abortion because just only black people were having abortions. No, it's
others, everybody was starting to have it.
I call it the Egypt-Israeli, children of Israel syndrome.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The only reason Pharaoh decided to enslave them is because they thought they were going to be outnumbered.
Absolutely.
Because they knew they were anointed to fight.
That's good.
I'll say they're anointed to fight because even Abram and his few men were wiping people out. And as long as they were there, Egypt was protected just because of their presence, because the legend was out. Oh, those children of Israel are there. So there's no way we can win.
That's a good effect. I think that's exactly what happened here. So they got involved. Jerry Falwell, Francis, and the Catholics especially. They definitely got involved in that. For Catholics, for religious purposes. But the evangelicals, what's that movie? Where are all the white women at? Blazing Saddle.
I was just watching that the other night.
Where all the white women? Great.
I saw the unedited version.
I did too. So we're going to D, the moral majority, which Falwell started, the moral majority, and we call this the moral majority versus Ronald Reagan.
In the summer of 1979, Falwell, at the urging of conservative operatives, launched a political organization he called the Moral Majority to bring evangelicals back into national politics.
We were desperate to have our voice heard and concluded that one way to get it heard was to register a bunch of people who had never registered and encourage them to vote.
One nation.
The idea was, we need to, quote, save the country.
I'd like to say there is no Bible belt in America. There's a Bible cloak in America that covers the whole blooming republic, and they're everywhere ready for the leadership preachers that you and I can offer them, and let's give it to them.
In only a year, Moral Majority had organized in 47 states, aiming to mobilize 10 million evangelical voters for the next election. In his 1980 campaign, Ronald Reagan set out to capture their votes.
You know, it's fascinating because Reagan was not particularly church-going himself. But I think as a very smart politician, he understood this movement as having great potential.
That's what's funny about Reagan. You have these sort of great champions of religion in American life, like Dwight Eisenhower, you know, who really is seen as a big figure behind the religious revival of the 1950s, and Reagan behind this political push in the 1980s, but neither was particularly religious.
During the campaign, Reagan arranged to speak at an evangelical convention where he made a dramatic gesture.
Now, I know this is a nonpartisan gathering, and so I know that you can't endorse me, but I only brought that up because I want you to know that I endorse you and what you're doing.
We had been on the fringes of the culture. Evangelicals were considered obscurantist, sweat-drenched, Appalachian hillbillies. And for someone running for president to affirm us was very significant. I think evangelicals, once that was said, lined up behind Reagan in mass.
Because we know that you're going to put this man into office. He says all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Reagan embracing the Christian right helped him immensely in 1980 against Carter. I mean, look, the economy was in terrible shape. The hostages were in Iran. Carter was going to lose. But this was a piece that came into the Reagan coalition and helped turn that election into a virtual landslide.
Preserve, protect, and defend.
The Constitution of the United States.
The Constitution of the United States.
So help you God.
So help me God.
Now, I congratulate you, sir.
I remember when Ronald Reagan became president, and that afternoon I noticed Falwell all alone, and he was listening to the radio, and he kept saying, I can't believe it. They're giving us credit for electing Ronald Reagan. And I think he was partly shocked and partly thrilled.
He was shocked and thrilled. The conservatives got Ronald Reagan in. I think they banded together, just like we did for Harold Washington. We got him in Chicago. But from Roosevelt, I would say Eisenhower of the 1950s, who seemed like a saved president, the only saved president we had.
Well, what did Carter do so wrong? They just didn't like his modest assertions.
Mm-hmm.
But he wasn't as liberal as one would think.
Back then, they thought he was, though. If you
economically, he was.
Economically, he was. And plus, he was part of that party. So if you're part of the party, then
you just associate.
Yeah. So it's guilt by association. But we have Eisenhower, who presented America back to God in a sense because of his language. Okay, matter of fact, he publicly said anybody who don't believe in God is foolish. All right, that's from the president of the United States. And then after him, God out of the mouth of the presidents were mute,
mm-hmm.
because then we had JFK.
Yeah.
You didn't hear nothing about God. And then you had Lyndon Baines Johnson. Okay. Mm.
Oh no!
Not much of God out of his
mouth.
No.
Okay.
No. And then we had I am not a crook. Okay. Nixon. No. You didn't hear. The only time you heard God.
That's funny because Nixon was a Quaker.
Yeah.
Very religious people.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. But
and very. Very, you know, and he pushed religion heavily,
mm-hmm.
but
it wasn't me. Nah, he didn't push it on America. And then, of course, after him, Gerald Ford wasn't voted in. He just got it because somebody else moved out of the seat.
Mm-hmm.
And then after him, of course, came Doc Carter, who was religious.
Mm-hmm.
But unfortunately, he was a Democrat. Because again, we're talking about the white churches and the, especially that Southern Belt and that evangelical part. Now there were evangelicals who were liberals, okay, but they were wasn't as vocal as what Jerry Falwell had accomplished. Okay, so this marriage of Ronald Reagan and the Moral Majority came together and they got that man in that office, and then they figured we get something in return. Okay, you made us some promises and we need it in return, all right?
Mm-hmm.
Now you're going to start seeing a pattern from Ronald Reagan all the way until today, okay? Let's go to E. I'm calling this a political smoke and mirrors.
In Reagan's Washington, one of the key lobbyists for the evangelical movement was Richard Cizik.
What I had previously seen as the irrelevance of American evangelicals all of a sudden turned, and they became relevant.
Please sit down. We absolutely.
These folk who had previously considered politics dirty and not worth sullying their hands over moved into the center of the debate.
Let me thank you, first of all, for that ad, but more than that, I know what you've been doing yourself and on the radio and everything else in support of us. I really want to tell you how grateful I am.
To the evangelicals, Reagan seemed ready to put their social agenda into action.
Our positive stance on family and children is consistent with our heartfelt convictions on the issue of abortion. Here again, we're not just against an evil. We're not just anti-abortion. We're pro-life. In the meantime, we in government will see to it that not one tax dollar goes to encouraging any woman to snuff out the life of her unborn child.
In the campaign, Reagan had advocated a constitutional amendment banning abortion. And in office, he proposed an amendment to reinstate prayer in public schools.
The president just gave to us the final wording of the constitutional amendment regarding voluntary prayer in public schools.
No one will ever convince me that a moment of voluntary prayer will harm a child or threaten a school or state. But I think it can strengthen our faith in a creator who alone has the power to bless America.
I don't know what a being could do more rapidly and more intelligently and more accurately and in keeping with his promises than Ronald Reagan has done. I give him A+ on everything.
I don't think you're right.
And it was heady stuff. I attended those Rose Garden meetings with the president and the briefings in the White House and the rest, and saw how the evangelicals had soaked up their newfound relevance. Unfortunately, with it came the arrogance that we're right and everybody else is wrong.
I think a lot of Americans coming out of the 1980 election were wondering what had happened. Here you have this new political force that is making itself felt in American society, in American politics. And so Americans generally were quite anxious about what was going on with the religious right.
Mm. And so Ronald Reagan made them promises, and he said that he was going to try to get in voluntary prayer and rid out abortion, all these things. If you notice, we still have that same problem today.
Yes.
Okay, so if America is a Christian nation, how is it possible that these people joined together to vote in a president, and so these people and the president could not push for moral change in America? Now, in the presidents, and hopefully by the end of the show, I'm trying to see if I can go try to push my agenda on Christians' involvement in politics, and why is it that we have to be careful how much of our hearts we give to political leaders? Because I know what y'all did with these presidents, especially who you are Christians. You guys were trying to vote on the moral side of these men. All right. Unfortunately, trying to vote on the moral side of these men and push them into that seat in the White House, what you were trying to do was trying to put a preacher in those seats. But the president of the United States office is not a religious seat. It is a secular political seat. And this is the problem, and this is the mistake that the moral majority and many of the white evangelicals made, and we made them too, who were, I'm not liberal, but I'm going to pump myself in that area because of my Democratic stand back in the day. I don't have a Democratic stand anymore. I'm really more Republican than anything. I have their values. I just don't have many of their racist stands.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? It's unfortunate to put racism and Republican together, but every time if you look at the National Republican Convention, look at how many thousands of people in there and watch how many black people you can count.
It'll be easy to count them.
It's going
to
be very easy to use one hand.
Maybe two.
Yeah, maybe two. All right. And if you use the other hand, is because those are the ones who have to clean up around the place when they're done.
Oh, yeah, the workers.
The workers.
And even them don't get the work.
Okay. So this is political smoke and mirrors. And then we're going to F. Y'all keep up with me. We at F now. Senator Ted Kennedy walks
Uh-oh.
In. All right. And this is Ted Kennedy versus Ronald Reagan. Now watch how the both of them try to pull from the Christian right. They both are campaigning in front of them, trying to gear them one way or the other. Ted Kennedy was very candid with them and let them know, okay, y'all keep pushing these Christian views, but I'm going to let you know it's gonna hurt you. He almost was prophetic. Okay, and Ronald.
And he was Catholic.
Yeah, he was Catholic. Sure was. Okay, let's see what this fight is all about.
In 1983, Senator Ted Kennedy came to Jerry Falwell's Liberty Baptist College to articulate that anxiety and to caution evangelicals about the dangers of allowing religious faith to dictate the actions of government.
The separation of church and state can sometimes be frustrating for women and men of religious faith. They may be tempted to misuse government in order to impose a value which they cannot persuade others to accept. But once we succumb to that temptation, we step onto a slippery slope where everyone's freedom is at risk.
I went with Ted Kennedy to Liberty Baptist, and the argument he made there was, number one, that you could not, in essence, excommunicate people from the public dialogue because you disagreed with them on the basis of religion. And number two, that you couldn't take every tenet of your religion, or even major tenets of your religion, and necessarily demand that they be written into public law, especially when there was no consensus about that.
The same year Senator Kennedy warned evangelicals, President Reagan seemed to tighten his rhetorical embrace of them.
And the book of John is the promise that we all go by. It tells us that for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. With his message and with your conviction and commitment, we can still move mountains. We can work to reach our dreams and to make America a shining city on a hill. Before I say goodbye...
With this shining city on the hill. And Reagan is really going back to the very origins of American colonialism, the British colonies, and this sermon on the Arabella that was given by the first governor of Massachusetts, where he said America will be a city on a hill. We're going to be this place that across from Europe they will look and they will see, yeah, that's how we want our society to be. And Reagan picked up on that. And with his great sort of California-American optimistic ebullience, he added the word shining. Shining city on the hill. It won't just be the city on the hill, but we'll be the shining city on the hill. And so in that rhetoric, you get the sense of sort of religion, Bible, Puritans, tradition, that this is a religious place.
America, America, God shed his grace on thee. Thank you again.
Reagan was a master at political symbolism. So when Falwell hears City on a Hill, what he hears is that this is going to be a Christian nation. We're going to try to propagate this Christian vision of politics and religion, not only in America, but more broadly throughout the world.
And you have to be careful when you're being patriotic. It's difficult to be patriotic and not religious, because if you listen to the patriotic songs and how we come together patriotically,
God is throughout the lyrics.
He's throughout it. Okay. Yes. And what it does, though, it causes we who are Christians to look at these people
through a lens.
And a lens, as Paul says,
darkly.
Dark. Yeah. It's fade. You ever picked up a something off the ground, or like whether it's a Coca-Cola glass and you're looking through it's I saw a lady at church the other night. She had her glasses on, and one side was foggy. You know, I'm like, how are you seeing through that foggy lens?
Only one of them was foggy.
One of them was foggy, yeah.
And that she was walking the fence. She was straddling the fence.
She was straddling. Yeah. And
that's the eye she was looking at you with lust.
And I think that's how we look. That's how some Christians look, through the eyes foggy. I can't even look at you. Okay, now, but watch this. Ted Kennedy told the truth.
Yes, he did.
All right, now, he told the truth.
But from a political perspective.
From a political perspective.
Because if we allow one faith to mm-hmm. have their way, mm-hmm. it's going to set precedence for other mm-hmm. faiths mm-hmm. to legally form an argument and have their way.
That's it.
And that's exactly what they did, civil rights, to then and now.
Yep. Yep.
I think it was unfair for them to use that agenda to push their agenda, but they did. But
that's my point. It's all political. So Ronald Reagan came, and he started trying to preach a religious sermonettes to them, using their own vernacular.
You're right.
Barack Obama went to the funeral of those nine, of the pastor who was shot.
Yes.
Okay. And he started singing Amazing Grace, I think it was.
Yeah.
You see how he upripped that room? Okay.
And he ain't telling him.
Huh?
He should have sang Let's Stay Together.
Yeah, he said exactly. Okay.
He should have.
Yeah, but you see what he was doing.
Yeah, he was spinning it.
Yeah. Every politician who come to your church, they'll get up and they'll use religious rhetoric and words and phrases that you understand. Like their brother, the comedian just said. Just say Jesus. Or yeah. Mrs. Johnson. One of the two. And you're going to win Christians over every time.
Hey. That's why they call it sheep.
Who?
Sheep.
Sheep, that's right.
Sheep for the slaughter. Sheep.
Yes, sir. We are.
Because sheep are a very dumb animal.
We're very dumb. Yeah. Lexi and Pam Henry going to give a skit on white church versus black church. Very hilarious, by the way. 5:00. Sir Walter Jones Show.
Good morning. It's 9:45 and it's time for worship. Today, our musician Brad, he's sick. Want to announce to everybody, he has mono. We're praying for him, but our musician for today is Dante. Thank you, Dante, for being here. Thanks. Let's pray. Lord, we love you. Not a lot of instrumentation. God is not loud. He's quiet.
I'm late. I know I'm late. Better be glad I'm here. Come on up, Sister Jackson. Come on here, Darius. Get this here. I'm tired. Everything that could go wrong did go wrong this morning. Dog was barking. Kids was begging for money. Husband acting a fool. Car wouldn't start. Oldest son took the car. Didn't leave a drop of gas in the car. But I'm here today. Curlers wouldn't get hot. Bank account is empty. Tires went flat. Had to get fixed a flat this morning. I don't know if my son drove over a nail or what. No, the nigga need to get out of my house. I'm tired of it. But I'm here this morning. And you gonna sit there and look at me like you can't give God some praise?
We love you, Lord. You're so good to us. Thanks. Now that's good. That's really good.
I didn't have to be here. I'm going through the change of life. I'm hot. I sweated out of 3 outfits already this morning. I am hot. Well, it's all heaven. If you're not going to be ready, musician, you can go home now. You can go home now.
And Lord Jesus, our Christ, oh, we love you. You know why we love you, Lord? He's amazing. You're simply amazing.
What are you doing? Are you texting? You social camming? You ready now? It's your world. I'm just living in it. You ready? Well, it's all heaven. Well, it's all heaven. Well, it's all heaven.
You know, Chelsea, when I think about our Christ, the only word that comes to mind, he's amazing. Yeah. And so, from our heart, and from the deepest part of our soul, we just want to say to you, hi. Good morning. Amen.
Well, it's all heaven. Oh, heaven is mine, yes. Oh, heaven is mine, yes.
This morning, because I love to come into his presence, and I can always tell when he's here because it smells like cotton candy, a little bit of bubble gum, and sweet kettle caramel corn.
Oh, yeah,
yeah, and Febreze. That's the Holy Spirit.
It's all heaven.
Heaven is mine.
I need something to drink. I need. Change of life. Thank you. Well, it's all heaven.
Next week.
Will you sing with me?
Yeah.
Let's do it. Sing with me, how great is our God.
In my bones. Shut up.
Sing up.
Shut up.
following show is paid programming and does not necessarily express the views and opinions of Urban Broadcast Media and its subsidiaries.
Thank you for listening to UBM Praise.
The Word of God is powerful, often misunderstood, but with proper study, you can gain accurate application of this potent source of life here on the Sir Walter Jones Show.
What you want me to say?
Speak, Lord.
I done said it in the whole 66 books.
Holy Spirit.
Yes.
You smell like Febreze.
Marsha.
Oh, Prince of Akita. Yeah, man. That was, now, I know some of y'all saying that's exaggerated. Please, I live in South Dakota. I went through that. Both sides is not exaggerated. Both of them. Matter of fact, I'm going through that right now all week. I'm in church. And that's all I've been hearing. Whew. I got gout. My back is out. I got a left eye messing with my right eye.
And my pinky toe swole.
It's swole up. Y'all,
but I'm gonna still dance for the Lord.
And what y'all come here for?
Cause I need nothing, absolutely nothing, separating me from the love of God. Yeah.
Yep, and that's from somebody who was hoarse. Now, if I could just talk, you know, I'm a little hoarse now. But
oh
I'm,
yeah, that's the other one.
I'm gonna sing this song here now.
Get the disclaimer right away.
And then when they forget the words, they shout. They shout.
And don't let the heel break, the great, or right, fall
the,
off.
The great cover up, I call it. Yeah.
In doubt, shout.
So we did A, blame Jerry Falwell. B, the Francis Schaeffer effect. C, Roe versus Wade effect. D, the moral majority versus Ronald Reagan. E, political smoke and mirrors. F, Senator Ted Kennedy telling the truth versus Ronald Reagan, who, well, y'all heard of Reaganomics. Uh-huh. And so, G is the evangelical divide and fall. Now, here are some broken political promises given by these people who you thought you can trust on helping America come back to its moral beginnings, which there really wasn't any.
So say you.
There wasn't a moral beginning.
Can't believe it.
G, the evangelical divide and fall.
Evangelicals felt empowered by the support of the Reagan administration, and they intensified their critique of what they saw as moral decay in American society.
After all, if we can just keep getting more of our men to have sex with more men, we won't have to worry about babies being born. And if we can just get more women to get out there in the marketplace and start acting like men, and if we can just get other women to look at motherhood as though it is some dread terminal illness, if we can just get society so drunk and so drugged, if ever anybody does get pregnant, then we can abort the baby. That's where we are.
But other American evangelicals thought that the religious right had it wrong.
The evangelical movement has been hijacked by a cabal of television preachers and far-right political operatives in a right-wing political cause that bears no resemblance to the gospel of Jesus Christ. Let's take it back.
Reverend Jim Wallace had created a liberal evangelical movement focused on issues of peace and social justice.
People felt like the religious right had just taken over the country. And this is so political and so partisan, and it is so much aimed at gaining political power. A lot of folks were saying, wait a minute, I'm a person of faith too, and they don't speak for me.
Moral majority, we say no.
As the religious right seemed at the height of its power, their heated rhetoric and a series of scandals involving prominent televangelists set off a backlash.
You say, well, I believe in freedom of choice. I do too, but you ought to make the choice before you get in bed.
Jerry Falwell thrived on being disliked to some degree. I think he enjoyed that sort of thing. He liked being at the center of controversy, and he knew how to stir it up.
That's okay.
By the late 1980s, Jerry Falwell's crusade was faltering. Public opinion polls showed that his popularity had fallen dramatically.
And you'll find Reagan late in his administration trying to put some distance between himself and Falwell and some of the other leaders of the religious right because of some of the things that they had done. Didn't look very good in the eyes of many Americans.
And many evangelicals felt let down by President Reagan, believing he had never used his full political clout to push their social agenda.
Ronald Reagan knew how to please evangelicals without giving them anything in return. Major constitutional amendments went nowhere. And the White House gave lip service to these, I know. I heard the lip service all the time. But not really. They wouldn't spend the president's capital to go to Capitol Hill and lobby legislators on behalf of these ideas. Not really.
What did Reagan do for us in 8 years of office? He gave us credibility, and he ultimately did nothing in terms of our long-term agendas.
In the wake of the Reagan years, Jerry Falwell would disband the moral majority.
I will not be stumping for candidates again. I will never work for a candidate as I did for Ronald Reagan. I am now rededicating my life to the preaching of the gospel.
Thank you. God bless you.
The torch of evangelical political engagement was picked up by Pat Robertson. His Christian coalition took a different course, focusing not on presidential politics, but on organizing evangelicals at the grassroots level.
Thank you. Yeah. In my organization, we have people who have been given, they have been given titles, but they have no authority.
Okay.
Okay. For instance, we have what's called auxiliary bishops. They don't have a jurisdiction. They just
a name.
They have a name out of honor, just like honorary doctorate. Okay.
Okay.
It wasn't now auxiliary bishops. Yeah, they did earn that title, but
how?
There is no by the life that they lived.
Okay.
Okay. Now then you have what's called state mothers, but without charge. So when they acknowledge you, they'll say, Mother Johnson, state substance, without charge. They have to say that. Okay? So she just had entitled, but there's nobody behind her. There's just a man or woman taking a walk. Okay? Pretty much. Okay? And I think that's what's going on here, is that they gave these people.
They used them.
Yeah, they used them. That Ronald Reagan used them. He got them up there and said, okay, yeah, and I'll bring you into my cabinet, and you be my advisor to the cabinet. You do it. Oh, man, they were just so proud. All right, Jerry Falwell realized he didn't pass nothing. He didn't give us anything. Well, he said all he did was gave us some
accolades and acknowledgments, but we got nothing
done. We got
done.
Nothing done. And that is the
Well, actually, something
effect.
Was done. It was damage done.
It was damage.
Because socially, in the eyes of the public, the religious right or the Christian movement took a huge blow because they didn't stand on their own agenda. They lined up with his.
That's it.
And they both used each other.
That's it.
And we ended up taking, or the religious religious right ended up taking what's the word when you're in war? They are the casualties of that war.
That's good. Yeah.
Because now everything is attacking Bible and religious right.
Yep.
And they're blaming the religious right and those people for what politicians who had no connection to the religious right at all.
Mm-hmm.
So it was an easy scapegoat.
Oof, man.
So now that's knowing the Lord in the fellowship of his suffering.
Yes.
In the pardon of your sins.
Part of your sins. And it's a mixed emotion situation, because then you ask yourself the question, okay, should they have gotten involved at all?
They should have gotten involved, but not on the premise of supporting one particular person without holding him to task.
Now,
we've seen this happen. And the people that have done it now politically in our day with our present POTUS, they have become obsolete because when you hold people in power to task, somebody in his camp begin to remove or mask certain things. So now some of our strongest voices have been silenced, either through incarceration or through scandal.
Yes. Good.
So they had the ability. They were given a golden opportunity to reflect God's glory by speaking out, by crying loud, by sparing not, because there was no scandal at all.
Right. Yeah.
They were just the church.
Yeah.
And they didn't do it. So now we were stuck with politicians who said, okay, that ain't right. I know I did this, but that ain't right. Right. And I know you did that. Don't tell, because I got something on you. Oh, but now I'm going to tell on you before you can tell on me.
Man, that's that sowing discord.
Yes. And trust, some often hit the fan.
Now, oh, some often.
George Ryan is out of jail.
Oh, yeah, I know.
And, dude, he's writing his book.
Yeah.
I've heard him on the radio before Tyler Wines died.
He
going
to tell.
He got a huge tell-all.
Oh, yeah. You know who's going to have to tell? Who's going to tell? The other governor.
Yeah. Blanco?
Yeah, Blanco.
Blanco got a whole lot to tell. That's why he said, what are y'all doing?
Yeah, yeah, he going
to
tell.
I do what everybody's done. That's what he said. I don't understand how you hypocrite. Oh. Mm-hmm.
He going to tell, and Jesse Jr. going to tell, too.
Jesse Jr. probably has the least to tell,
but
he had the biggest voice because he had the heart of people.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they got him on. He made the mistake, in my opinion, of doing what he saw them doing when he knew he shouldn't have been.
He shouldn't have done. Yeah.
The glove? Come on.
Oh, yeah.
Dame Jackson, you don't need his glove.
Right, right. Please. And guitars. Elvis, yeah. I think Elvis guitar. Paul Rogers, my cousin out there in the second place called Hell. That's
well, Hell has enlarged itself because his house sits right over it. Because it's hot damn Phoenix.
Hot damn Phoenix. He said the problem with evangelicals is that they thought Ronald Reagan and Jerry Falwell were Jesus, and then they died.
Yes, I saw that. Yes.
That's profound.
Yeah, it is. They died and didn't resurrect.
Yeah, see?
They ain't come back.
Yeah, and he says 2014, Kojic ordained 65 bishops in only 16 jurisdictions. Now, I want y'all to get this now.
That's money.
There's 65 bishops
that have to give a report,
but there's only 16 jurisdictions.
Man, keep the title. Because I got to pay to have them file letters by my name.
Now he understands because he come from that.
I understand.
Yeah, and that's what it's all about. And once I put my collar on and I walk into those rooms, I'm telling you, they ask me, bruh, where's your check?
Yeah, your report.
Uh huh. But when I wear my collar, they don't ask me for money.
Because you know you ain't got to do it no uniform. So why wear the collar?
I can't go there. It's that is a jurisdiction in itself.
I understand.
Yeah, it's a and but then there's the issue of jurisprudence on their end. Okay, let's go to let's go to H. In walks George W. Bush.
Oh Lord.
The madness continues.
In 2000, the presidential campaign brought evangelicals new hope for success in national politics.
For many evangelical voters, George W. Bush was the candidate they had been waiting for, and that he brought together the right conservative stance on issues that mattered to them. But he also had the evangelical identity.
When you turn your heart and your life over to Christ, accept Christ as a Savior, it changes your heart, changes your life. And that's what happened to me.
And so instead of having another Ronald Reagan, for example, who was a conservative, but not necessarily personally religious, they finally had somebody who could share their identity and could share their politics.
With the election of George Bush, it was assumed that we had accomplished our goals. And once an evangelical is in that power, he has the ability then to call the shots.
Mm-hmm. I remember when George Bush was running, they was worshiping that man. And they was telling us who are Christians, you better vote for him because the other guy who's going to run this country down to a state of Satanism.
They stole it for him.
Yeah.
Not knowing once his record came out.
They had not a clue. Again, it's amazing how we keep getting let down. You would think that Ronald Reagan situation would have been a test, a wake up, okay? And they still to this day, if you use Ronald Reagan's name,
they
bow down and say, "Oh, he is the greatest since Jesus is the greatest disciple." and he had three that he really liked. They call them the what they call those three boys. We talking about, well, it was the three that was on the Mount of Transfiguration with him.
They call him the circle. His circle. Peter, James, and John, by the way. Eve Cook, Principal Keita, I have to call her two names because, you know, you don't know her by her alias.
Now you done put it out there. Now
I put it out there every time I read it. First of all, Natalie Bullock says, wow, hoodwinked. And they are still singing his song and dancing to his tune. I think she's talking about Ronald Reagan. Eve Cook says, seriously, though, that soundbite demonstrated an emotional stance in the white church and black church. In the white church, it demonstrated the non-struggle and freedom to worship God as they have always had. And in the black church, it demonstrated the struggle with the believer and harshness of trying to connect with the flow of the spirit. And then Natalie says, yes, religious right is now the whipping boy of the media, where in the 80s, they were all you heard from. We just didn't know how ineffective their efforts were at the time. And I agree with that statement, especially because a lot of times after a president is dead and gone for a while, we then begin to realize years later the effect he had on the economy.
Whether or not he was actually effective or not.
Absolutely. Yeah, because they were worshiping Roosevelt.
And he was tearing stuff up.
And they didn't realize that he was actually doing more damage than he was doing good in some instances, because he didn't know how to stir up the economy by spending was good, actually. Not spending is bad. That's why it's called a stimulus. In order to stimulate.
You got to have something to spend, to give into it.
Exactly.
But he was doing more spending than they had. He was spending on credit.
I see that.
So he put him in debt, because after a while,
right,
you know, it was my money.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. You give to the people, let them spend.
Right.
Okay. And this is the thing that David Rogers was talking about Monday. He was saying how Chicago has put all of this money into, of course, sports, the Maggie Daly Park.
Corporations.
Nothing
in the hands of the people.
The billions of dollars we spend on defense. Okay. But your children right now want to go to college. They got to really fight to get some money, okay? They will receive a no way before they receive a yes. And if they get a yes, it'll be this amount of money.
You're going to tell me I'm doing trunk parties this Saturday. I understand. Loud and clear.
You're right. All the billions we have spent, okay? And then in that spending, I think we lost about 6,000, 7,000 people, okay, of us.
That's what they're telling us.
You can't even count how many Iraqis.
Let's just talk about the injured too,
who were murdered.
Number doesn't include the injured, the permanently maimed. Right. You know, mm-hmm. which if you've been permanently handicapped, that's like a death.
It really is. So how in the world can we be in such a rich and free nation where you can't even offer to educate us?
It becomes a free nation, a rich nation when you are rich in the nation.
Yeah.
And you have the power.
Man, that's good stuff.
Be broke and in the nation and say I'm in a rich nation.
Yeah.
And I may get a little of the crumbs that fall from your table, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. which would be better than some other places. Yeah. And they say be grateful for that. If we're all the same, how come I don't have what you have?
Wow. Since I've been going at this all week, tomorrow may have to be that subject. Let's go to Evangelicals versus the Republicans. Now, this is a good soundbite here. I want you to listen very closely here. Here goes the evangelicals on this side, and they begin to rally around the Republicans, okay? Because if you turn on Fox News or go to any Republican anything, you'll see a lot of conservative evangelicals there, all right? They rushing in to the Republicans, all right? And you know what fools rushing in?
Yeah.
Where wise men fear to tread.
Yes.
Okay, let's see.
In his 2000 campaign, George Bush had courted this younger generation of evangelical voters, promising a new, compassionate conservatism. In office, he would enact policies advocated by younger evangelicals. He spoke out on the genocide in Darfur and proposed new funding to fight HIV/AIDS in Africa.
Tonight, I propose the emergency plan for AIDS relief. A work of mercy beyond all current international efforts to help the people of Africa.
Bush did not forget the older generation of his evangelical supporters.
he signed a bill banning late-term abortions and restricted embryonic stem cell research.
Well, the biggest thing he did for older evangelicals was to put Justices Roberts and Alito on the Supreme Court. And in the long run, on the issues they care about, Alito and Roberts are going to push that court in a conservative direction. And that's exactly what a lot of religious conservatives were looking for.
But as the Bush presidency bogged down with the war in Iraq, it became clear that yet another Republican administration would fail to push through key parts of the evangelical agenda, including constitutional amendments banning abortion and gay marriage.
George W. Bush turned out to be a huge disappointment to evangelicals.
There was a feeling that, hey, we worked all these years, we elected all these people, and what do we really have to show for?
After a 30-year journey into politics, some veterans of the evangelical movement concluded their strategy had been flawed.
We too often acted like just another lobby group, treating the Republican Party as synonymous with our agenda.
Ultimately, it's evangelicalism that suffers. We lose our capacity to be an arbiter in society of what is moral and immoral, because we've sold our birthright out to one political party. There's a huge danger in getting too involved in the political process. You can either be a prophet who stands on the outside of culture and argues against the injustices, or you can be the king. And I don't think you can be both.
A lot of the changes that the Christian right wanted were cultural changes. To use their own language, sort of changes of the heart. But you can't really change that much through electing presidents, because by definition it's cultural. But they did change our politics in that they brought religion and politics closer and closer together, and they created a model that was effective that the Democrats have now taken up.
I don't know if I agree with that, because Democrats, I guess locally, Democrats have always used the church.
Yes.
In this city they have.
Absolutely, yes. And those of you, first of all, the files are clipping. It's not your phone, your apps, or the website. That's us over here, so don't be looking at your phone like, hey, why is this clipping? But notice he said, we got too involved in one party. Mm-hmm. We should not have done that.
Right.
Okay. And that's both sides. That's also the Democratic side as well. But then John Kerry began, you know, he ran. I believe he was Catholic or something like that. But he said, in his mind, he figured, you know what? The far right, they made the mistake by bringing up this religious stuff. And you see what he got them? He says, I'm not going to do it. So he didn't do it, but he was proven wrong. He lost the Christian liberal vote because he ignored religion. In walked Barack Obama. Okay. Barack Obama proved that religious people bring their religion with them.
Of course they do.
To the town square.
But that's what Bush did.
Uh-huh.
That's how Bush got reelected, because he had us focus on the same-sex marriage, the abortion issues, and all those things. All the while, he was following a whole other agenda.
Yes, sir.
On the side, it's like playing with a baby.
Yes,
if you want to get something from the baby, show them something else, distract them, they'll put it down.
Yes,
because
sir.
They're not ambidextrous.
Yes.
They can't focus twice.
Right.
So you show them something that looks more appealing or that gets their attention, they'll put the bottle down or whatever,
sir.
Or and go after what you're showing them when you can get what you want from them. It's easy to take something from
easy.
A baby.
Woo! Man, and that's what Christians are. Babies.
All religious orders
are babies.
Yeah.
And that's why we drink the Kool-Aid so easy. Yeah. 5:30 in the p.m. Chicagoland, y'all.
Alkaline water.
Uh-huh. Alkaline water. Ebony and Ivory's about the same. Stevie Wonder.
Sir Paul McCartney.
Sir Walter Jones Show.
Ebony and ivory live together in her. There is good and bad in everyone. And we learn to live, we learn to give each other what we need to survive. Together alive, ebony and ivory, live together in perfect harmony, side by side on my piano keyboard. Oh Lord, why don't we?
In 1982, y'all, number one single by Paul McCartney and Stevie Wonder. It was released March 29, I believe it was, that year. The song was featured on the McCartney's album, Tug of War.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, the song reached number one on both UK and US charts. At the simplest level, the song is about the ebony, black, and ivory, white keys on the keyboard, but also deals with integration and racial harmony on a deeper human level. The title was inspired by McCartney hearing, Spike Milligan's, or I think it's Milligan's, that's what it is, black notes, white notes. And you need to play the two to make harmony, folks. The figure is much older. It was popularized by James Agri in the 1920s, inspiring the title of the Pan-African Journal. The Keys is what it's called. But was used from at least the 1840s. Written by McCartney alone. I'm surprised Stevie didn't have a hand in the writing. The song was performed live in the studio by McCartney and Wonder, though due to conflicting work schedules, both recorded their parts for the song music video separately, as explained by McCartney in his his commentary for the McCartney Years, the 3D box. Yeah, it goes on and on. Good history. That's what, I know I'm a history nerd, but I love doing it because a lot of times, remember back in the day we used to listen to songs on the radio?
Yes.
And then we were waiting for the DJ to tell us
who it was.
Uh-huh.
And sometimes another song would play, and he'd only give the last song.
Yeah. So I said to myself, 30 years ago, if I ever had a show, I would always inform the people on what I'm playing.
Yes.
And so here I am 30 years later doing that. Be careful what you say.
Yeah.
Because you find yourself.
Do Never say never.
Yeah, never say never. And this is one of them good ones, though. Good goals to have. Because if I ever said, man, I ain't gonna never be a crackhead. So, yeah. That's pretty much the gist of it. Now, I would read this as, how should a Christian view politics if there is anything that will spark a spontaneous debate? It's, if not an outright argument, it is a discussion involving politics, even among believers. As followers of Christ, what should be our attitude and our involvement with politics? It has been said that religion and politics don't mix. But is that really true? Can we have political views outside of the considerations of our Christian faith? The answer is no, we cannot. Okay, here's the question again. Can we have political views outside the considerations of our Christian faith?
Is that a question for me, or you're just being hypothetical?
Hypothetical. Because the Bible gives us two truths regarding it.
Okay. Two truths?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, really?
The first truth is that the will of God permeates and supersedes every aspect of our life.
Okay.
Got it?
Yes.
Okay. It is God's will that takes precedence over everything else. Matthew 6:33. God's plan and purpose are fixed.
Okay.
Like your income. and
who says it was fixed?
and his will, well, if you get a paycheck from the job, that's fixed too. And his will is inviolable. What he has promised, he will bring to pass, and no government can thwart his will.
Mm-hmm.
Daniel 4:34. In fact, it is God who sets up kings and disposes
them. Yes, it does.
Daniel 3:21. Because the Most High is sovereign over the kingdoms of men and gives them to anyone he wishes. Daniel 4. A clear understanding of this truth will help us to see that politics is merely a method God used to accomplish his will. Even though evil men abuse their political power, meaning it for evil, God means it for good, working all things together for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose, Romans 8:28. So that's the first one. But the second one is, we must grasp the fact that our government cannot save us.
They were never designed to do so.
No.
You were designed to save it.
Yep, that's good. And so we put these people in office because we want them to save us. And then what we'll do is we'll put a preacher in office.
Yeah.
Thinking that he will save the nation or the territory that you live in at the time. And that don't happen. Okay, because politics is not a bed where religious people lie. It's not, because it's so corrupt.
It depends on the preacher you put in, number one. And it also depends on, I'll say it like this. If you put a true, sincere man of God in office, preacher or no preacher, 9 times out of 10, if he remains, it's because the demographic he serves, he's doing just enough to impact them.
And that's what
But his vote may always be in the mind of his constituents, but it doesn't have enough impact because he doesn't have enough to agree with him for the nation. For example, Mike Huckabee. Yes. I was a fan of his from the hit. He had my vote in the Republican primary. Had he won that, he would have had my vote for the national election. I just always believed in him. Something about him I discerned was he may not be perfect, but he'd be the man for the job. So here locally, you have men of God that are in office, and they've lasted because they're not preachers, but they're men of God that have served their constituents, and God keeps them there because sometimes there's just a watchman there or a remnant, you know. I guess they're the 10 righteous that God keeps in place to keep from destroying the land.
And I think that's a great way of summing that up. And notice I gave a precursor by saying, depending on the territory where they live.
Yeah.
The larger your territory, the weaker that religious politician gets, because he's up against more and more.
Unless that neighborhood or that district is filled with the same-minded people.
There you go. Absolutely. Because there are cities in our 9 states, even though they're small cities, they might be 80, 90% Christians.
Yeah.
And so that politician in that town is doing great if he's a Christian. But if he is the governor of that state, he may have a problem.
Yes.
Okay. Then if he's the president of the United States, he's got a bigger problem.
Yes.
Yeah.
And those are those people, when you watch television shows or you hear about lobbyists approaching people, they're those people are the only ones the lobbyists come and see them is when the vote is so tight.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And it's like, what do you need? What do you want? What do you want? All of a sudden, you may see donations or contributions or this and that in your community.
Yeah, you're right. You're right. I got a file here, Cat Williams.
Oh, Lord.
Yeah. Now, you know you got to. I edit the mess out of this because I had to.
I don't
to.
Even know if he was able to.
I mean, it was hard, but I had to edit this.
You hear a lot of
Yeah, yeah. Click, 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 click. Like, is he stuttered? He got Tourette's.
Beep.
Yeah. But this one here, it was so true to my life because he was saying, get you some white friends. Okay? You black folk out there who can count on one finger how many white friends you got, shame on you, first of all. All right? Same to you white people.
They won't stay my friends. I try.
I don't think I've lost one white friend.
They never say they're not my friend. They're just too busy to come over anymore.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay, so again, I'm glad I moved to South Dakota because I was able to know them and get to know them, and they became my friends. So get you some white friends, black folk, because dumb people will get you out of some trouble that your black friends, they either can't or they just ain't willing to do.
Yeah.
All right, so let's go to Cat Williams and see what he said about that.
Out and get you some white friends. Get you some white friends. You ain't gotta sleep with them, but you gonna need them. If you go to jail and call your nigga friends, these will interrogate you more than the police did. They'll have you on the phone. Where the was you at? What the was you doing? Why the you ain't call me? Not your white friends. Them will be there by the time you hang up the phone, and they'll be madder than you. Just what did he do? Murdered who? Look, I've been on it for 2 weeks. He wouldn't can do something like that. Gotta love white people. I don't give what you say. White people are friendly. You can call them up at 3 o'clock in the morning with the wrong number, and they won't even be mad at you. They just, hello? No, I'm sorry. No Shaquita here. Well, what number did you dial? No, it's a 9, not a 7. Well, try it. If it doesn't work, call me back. We'll figure this thing out. White people.
I'm telling y'all, as funny as that is, he's so
he's telling correct. The truth for
he's
sure.
Correct. I'm telling you, I've lived among them. That's the way they are. Now, this other one here, now, I'm letting the word nigga slip in there because I have a friend. He's still my friend, and we joke around in private, okay? So I'm letting y'all know some of our private jokes, and I had to realize I got to stop doing that. He called me nigga, and I call him hunky. Okay, that's what we were doing. For a long time. What up, nigga? I'm like, hey, what up, honky? Okay. And we didn't do that outside of me and him in the room, okay? We didn't play that stuff because people didn't understand.
No.
One time he made a mistake, though. We were at the theater.
Oh, no.
Yeah, and he forgot. And he said, hey, nigga. And I said, boy, you about to get killed up in here. He said, oh, my God, I forgot where I was. Okay, that's
how he was too comfortable with that word, man.
So I had to realize, Walter, okay, you're trying to kill the word, but then you're playing with this guy, with this lady.
Right,
you got to stop that. So
that Ritz, because I won't say crack. I mean that Ritz. Yeah, yeah.
So I stopped it. I shut it down. Okay, but then I walked in. Now, I had two friends that I did that with, okay? This other one is not my friend. He's not my friend anymore. Okay, white guy. It was the nigga hunky thing. It was the running joke. Okay.
Oh, so what, he said it.
I've been saying it since you've been sitting there. So I walked in. They thought I wasn't in the room. Okay. Oh. He was with his white friends. Oh. And I walked by the room and I heard the conversation. Mm. Yeah, them niggas out there. And I said to myself, he don't just say that to me.
Yeah,
he says it. He said that's a word he used among his friends.
Right.
And then I realized, and then when I was living in that territory, I realized that they were some of my white informants. They would say, Walter, you don't think all these people are your friends? He said, because they pile up with you because they'll get so far with you because they like the black culture. They'll come to your church. They'll come to your house. Yada yada yada. Okay, but again, you know the old standard. Yes. You can't date my daughter.
Right.
You just can't do it. All right. So they will. He says in our circle. Matter of fact, we played a file by what is his name? Monday,
Aaron Haig. I don't know if you have that file. Can you find that?
It doesn't say Aaron Haig remembered
because
you have it as another D.
I do?
Yes.
Yeah, Eric Haig. Yeah. It says remembered? I don't know what that. Okay, let's see what that file sound like. Okay. This is our. He was on our show, our white evangelist.
Yes,
okay, and let's hear what he's saying.
Now, yeah. Now listen. I have relationships with probably more white fundamental evangelical patriotic Christians in the Southwest than most of my Caucasian friends, and I have never, in any presidential race, seen so many efforts and attempts to keep an African-American out of office like I saw in President Barack Obama's first run at the presidential office. Sure. So I had to stop and ask myself the question. Letters were sent out to most of the evangelical world in the state of Oklahoma saying, do not vote for Barack Obama.
Wow.
Don't vote for him.
Wow.
Christian patriots.
Yeah.
But yet he finds himself in office.
Wow.
Why?
Why?
More reports, more letters sent out saying don't vote for him, but yet he shows up.
He shows up.
I believe it's the providential guidance of God.
Wow.
Allowing it to happen.
Yeah. And that's something that's, again, y'all, you know, these are some, I brought these men in because I knew that they would bring in what's called the shocking truth. Yeah. Yeah. And he says, this is a perfect example of what I just said prior to this file plan is in Aaron Haig's circle, his white Christian pastors.
Yes.
Was like, don't let that nigga in office.
Ooh.
Okay. Yeah. I'm telling y'all, this is the language. Now, this is some conversations he and I have had off air. Them black folk, don't you trust them? Now, Aaron comes into this area all the time, sometimes at night, on the train by himself. The Lord has protected him and shielded him. But when he go to his white evangelical brothers and sisters, they don't like you.
Not at all.
They don't like you. And I'm not saying all white people are that way who are evangelicals, because I have a lot of close ones who are on the street. They were in Ferguson marching. Mm-hmm. Okay? They were with Martin Luther King. I know who those are. I'm not talking about them on the show today. But you got Cat Williams who finishes. He says, now white folk, get you some nigger friends. Okay? And what he's getting ready to say here is this experience that I've experienced.
The exchange.
Okay, here we go.
White people, though, let me say this. Y'all need some nigga friends. Get you some nigga friends. Just don't ever, ever call them your nigga friends. Don't ever. That'll be a relationship up. There's my nigga friend. You guys say it all the time. What? White people, you need your nigga friends so they can tell you it is not appropriate. First of all, white people, please stop putting them little blue leashes on your children. Please stop doing that. That is only entertainment for niggas. That's all that is. We be excited then.
Look at her, look.
That's why white kids grow up and kill everybody in the school, because you done treated them like a German shepherd ever since they were three. They be in the store like, oh, I want them.
I'm telling you, you got to be careful who you call your friend.
What? Right. And then train them.
Yes.
See, we know how to comply in there.
Yes, we do.
But they have to understand. You got to know how to maneuver.
You got to know how to maneuver.
You know, it takes me back to the scene in Die Hard 3.
What?
When Bruce Willis had the billboard on.
Right. Right.
It says,
yes. That's exactly it.
Yeah, he had to go over there and save him because they were about to take him out.
They about to take him out. Yeah, and this is, again, y'all, I hope y'all understand here. You can be in a room with people and they'll say, I got your back.
Yeah.
But when they go amongst their own people.
Yes.
You just another nigga to them.
Yeah, what? You got careful.
Yes.
What show is this?
You just another nigga. Okay.
This is clip from another string.
Oh,
another,
this is
no, not cut from another cloth. Clip from another string.
So that's a Jones show.
Yes.
Yeah, we got shows combined.
You're hearing the whole stuff. Cut from another cloth.
Yeah.
Ronnie Austin. He's joined us in the studio.
And that fine sister with the hair.
Ah.
My Afrocentric woman over there. She just fine.
How come they always light skin? Trying to be Afrocentric.
I have no idea. So,
listen, I just got here in the all y'all people that's listening to this show.
Yeah, repent.
This some good stuff, ain't it?
Yes, sir.
So much is on show. Make no mistake about what show you're listening to.
you know we're recording this, right? So you know what's gonna happen come Monday, right?
Don't you? It's not payback.
Oh, see, man. Come Monday. Mine,
reciprocity. That's right.
Reciprocity. Yes, yes, sir.
Vengeance is mine, said the Lord. Yeah, you don't have to.
Said the Lord. So
you
not
got
you.
You got the weekend to heal.
you know, salvation is chasing you.
And I'm still running.
Cut from a different cloth, y'all. They're here and they come on at 6 o'clock in the p.m. Central here in Chicago, man. And if you want to hear some good gospel music, I'm telling you, this is the place to hang out. You know, they come in here with these papers and notes and stuff like this, with their songs on it, man. And
they are so organized.
They are so organized.
And it's a great show.
It really is. It really is. It helps me kind of get myself together because I don't be knowing what I'm doing on my show.
And he don't tell me nothing.
I don't tell him nothing. And he's right. Alvin C. Carter don't know the show until the whole world find out what the show title is. And he comes in here as if he prepared it himself. I love that, though, man.
But I hear you always say previously what the show going to be about before the next show.
No, I
well,
no,
sometimes
I don't.
You do.
Every now and then we'll talk and say what certain shows, like on Monday, we say, oh, we could talk about this on Thursday. Yeah. Or on Thursday we say, oh, we could talk about this next Wednesday. Mm-hmm. But still don't know the details.
We don't know the details. And then I change it depending on breaking news on TV.
Well, I will say this. This is truly an awesome show.
Thank you, sir.
I am privileged to all. I wasn't able to listen to the show today coming in because I forgot my phone.
Uh-oh.
Wow, how did you make it through the day?
You still breathing?
He got an
Apple Watch. Yeah.
That's a pair watch.
That's a pair watch.
It's the Samsung.
Oh,
the
Samsung
pair. Cannot do this.
It's a pair.
I know you love your apples, but apples is not independent.
I know you love
phone.
Your apples.
That's a pair. See?
And Samsung is.
Shameless plug.
Not that I'm giving them a plug. They got their issues.
They do have their issues. Hey, Brittany, bring up Jonathan McReynolds' Pressure. Okay. Yeah, bring that up. Start playing that because now that he's here, I'm feeling so pressured. I feel so pressured because this brother here, he always do this. And you come up with it, man, Alvin.
Oh, man.
You know?
This is mild.
This is mild.
Yes, he done got old.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, my God.
Imagine when he was younger and taller and thinner, man.
You got any white friends?
Yes.
You do?
Yes.
Now, I'm not going to ask you how many you got.
I have quite a few.
You do. You see? He got quite a few.
Look at his color. Yeah, he blends.
You do blend. Yeah, you can pass.
I have a lot of nationality friends, though.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. You look kind of Cuban, though. Can't even turn on my phone. You do. You got that. Is your middle name Esteban?
No, he's Juan. Ronnie Juan.
Ronnie Juan.
RJ.
They brought me on the show to insult me.
No.
Yes.
I didn't.
Flesh and blood did not reveal that to you.
But listen. Listen. I do have my show coming behind this.
Oh.
And I'll get the chance to
like
be
a Mongolian monk.
And we are cut from a different cloth.
Yes, you are.
So for all of you listeners that are here listening to Sir Walter Jones, stay around long enough to hear what I have to say as a rebuttal.
I'm going to get my rebut out of here, though. Yeah, man, I appreciate it. So we were talking about black America, white America. And why the divide? Help us out. Keep that playing, Britt. Why the divide?
The true reason why the divide?
Uh-huh.
That was never really coming together.
Okay.
It was forced.
Yeah.
And as we look back in history, our coming together was forced. Mm-hmm. That's why we still struggle with acceptance. That's why they still struggle with accepting us. Mm-hmm. We still have issues accepting them because ours is the only relationship that was forced.
Wow. That's true.
Good stuff.
That's true.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Makes a lot of sense.
And I think that's what we kind of talked about yesterday, about slavery was all over the world. Okay, everybody enslaved everybody. But America was the only nation in the world that enslaved people because of their color.
Mm-hmm.
other nations did it because of economical situations and class and all this stuff. And some people sold their own selves into slavery because they could not afford to do something. Such. But they said America's the only nation that because you're dark skinned.
Well, European nations. Spain started it. Mm-hmm. And
but they didn't do it because the person was black.
Right? No. They did it because of the quality of mm-hmm. the race mm-hmm. they were taking. Mm-hmm. The strength, the durability, and the natural senses that they had mm-hmm. by how they were raised in Africa.
Okay.
And then they were sold off by their own, which had nothing to do with race then.
Right. And then, but look what happened afterwards. So we kept it. They let it go.
They had to.
You see what I'm saying? Spain let it go. French let it go. European says, okay, we're done with you now. And then what they did was they went back to Sierra Leone and built places for the ex-slaves. And it's okay, they shipped others to Canada.
And they kicked them out. Yes. Y'all got to go.
Okay, we're done with it now. You can now. So now you notice.
They were afraid of uprisal.
You see what I'm saying?
And upheaval. Mm-hmm. Because mm-hmm. you got to realize these were people who were lost, who were victims of war, like we talked about earlier in the show.
Yes.
So these people knew how to fight innately. Yes. I mean, come on. They
yes.
They dealt with lions. We dealt with deer. I mean, this country dealt with deer. They dealt with lions. They dealt with rhinos. You know what I'm saying? That it was nothing for wild animals of the jungle to come in their community, and they warded them off. So, I mean, naturally, they knew how to defend themselves mm-hmm, over time. It was just a matter of them strategizing mm-hmm. and getting a common language so they can communicate.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Absolutely.
So they say, oh, they done coagulated now. We got to get them out of here. Y'all go back.
Yeah, and they said, because you're fighting for us, then we're going to free you. First of all, you got to be Catholic. That's what Spain said. And then when you're done fighting with us, we're going to free you. And then they let them move over to St. Augustine, Florida. Okay. United States didn't do that. We fought in the Civil War, the American Revolutionary War.
Every war ever.
And they still said, okay, now you fought against one of the soldiers or white soldiers. Okay, the war's over. Now go back.
I'm putting you in jail for killing a white man.
I mean, you look at the some of the pictures, and you look at the Moabs, yeah. You know, there with Columbus, you know, helping him navigate to get to what's not lost.
Yeah.
Yes.
But, you know, still relationships that are forged together for whatever reasons. Mm-hmm. And here in America, we just showing our true colors.
United Snakes.
I see your true colors. Hey, got to get out of here, y'all. I'm getting ready to get cut from three different cloths. Gotta go.
So watch the Jones Show.
And I'll prove it. I fear you. I don't like you. I hate you. Because I don't know you. I don't understand you or your culture or your religion or your race. Some only appreciate that which they know. You ever went to school with somebody or worked with someone and you thought they were mean or a jerk? But maybe one day you guys had to work together and you got to know them. And then you realize that they weren't mean or a jerk like you thought. So when someone sees a race that they don't know or understand, they can become critical. And that criticism turns into fear or hate. If you are white and you grew up in a black neighborhood, then your chances of being racist towards blacks are slim, and vice versa. If your parents let you play with other races, then chances of you being racist are slim. No child is born racist. Racism is learned and can be unlearned. A baby's mind is wide open. You can put whatever you want into it. The child will learn things consciously and unconsciously. Whatever goes on around that child goes into that child's mind. What were their parents' attitude towards other races? What types of people did their parents keep them from? Racist people are not 100% to be blamed for their condition. It was something that was embedded into them, something that they've learned. And we are the way that we are because of what we've learned, because of how we were raised. There's a reason that they are the way that they are. If you are loving, it's probably because you have parents who are loving. If you are kind and giving, it's probably because you have parents who gave. If you are loud and obnoxious, it's probably because your parents or whoever raised you was loud and obnoxious. Now, if someone is racist, it's probably something that they've learned, something they were taught. So when we see a racist person, instead of first judging, let's try understanding and asking ourselves, why are they like that? How were they raised? What were they taught? They are not full of hate because they can love. They love their spouses, they love their family, their friends, their loved ones, their children. But they choose to dislike a certain race. But why? So understand that it's something that's not permanent.
You've been listening to the Sir Walter Jones Radio Show, where he provides you with a biblical perspective for your everyday life. Stay connected to Sir Walter Jones by visiting him online at www.sirwalterjones.com or on Facebook at www.facebook.com/askTheElder. Stay tuned until next time with the Sir Walter Jones Show with Sir Walter Jones.